So this is will in fact be a summary of the presentation I was giving yesterday. Some of you were there, but not everyone. So it is a quite long presentation. So I was giving a rather large overview of all the applications that have been done with, well, not all of them, selection of the applications were done with Coherent. So there are several other ones which are done by users. They have published that in the literature, but I don't have any personal contact with them, so it is very difficult to show them. I think, first of all, that you know all now who I am. I'm Patrick Luiten from Brussels in Belgium. So I am team leader of the ecosystem modeling group, ECOMOD, at our institute. Which means that I'm now responsible for all and coordination for all the modeling activities we're doing at our institute. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about it, maybe now or maybe this afternoon. Is also foreseen at the end presentation from me.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So I will see. So my group is part of the operational directorate natural environment. So we had a restructuring of our institute 2 years ago. So our institute is the Royal Belgian Institute of Natural Sciences. So it's a very big institute. We have about six, seven hundred people in there. There are six directorates. There is a geological survey department. There is one on the museum itself. It's one on paleontology. But we are the biggest one. So it's about 110-120 people. So it's in the ODNATURE. And ODNATURE is mainly concerned with marine affairs. So not only marine, but also lakes, freshwater environments. Most of you know what coherence is. So it's a numerical model code, which is written in a general format so that it can apply to the very different areas. So the main application area for which it was designed originally was for regional and shelf seas, coastal zones. Can also do it in estuaries and in lakes. So the Finnish application showed quite well that it can be applied on lakes. It is also an integrated model, which means integrated that it does not only contain the basic physics which you should have in a model. So you have the Navier-Stokes or the shallow water equation in primitive form, but you have also the effects like turbulence, surface fluxes, and so on. But we have also now, and that is quite recently now, a fully developed sediment model, morphology, dredging relocations, and wave current interaction. That's quite recent, so that was in the release 2.8, which has been released in October. 2.9, sorry, that is the latest release. Structures. Release which has been done last year, and also you can put in the various types of discharges. Now I won't have the time today to discuss it in detail. I give a presentation yesterday afternoon. The presentations I think they are available, so you can always have a look at it. And of course, the code is free software code. That was the aim from the beginning, and it is available on our website. So some of you, the older users, so there was a V1 Coherence website, which is no longer supported, so it is no longer available. Now we have a V2 site, so we have a different address. The website is open since last year, but till now we didn't give too much publicity, but now we decided, I think it will become one of these days. So we will send a general message to the whole coherence community worldwide. We made up an address listing, and we have about 1,800 addresses, so mail addresses. So we're going to send a message to, but I'm afraid some of the addresses will no longer be correct because the email list exists since 2000. So some mail addresses have been changed. The code is also fully documented, so I remember in the past when I was staying in other countries, like in China, and they say, okay, what's the advantage of using Coherent? Because if you're looking worldwide, for instance, the ROMS model, that's the, I think nowadays the most popular regional model worldwide, say yes, but the ROMS model is not really documented. And Coherent has the documentation. Now, the documentation, as I explained yesterday, is a little bit in delay. So now, the last month, I'm a little bit obliged to produce several releases of the code, but the documentation will follow afterwards. And that's something new, which we didn't have on V1. So when we released the V1 code in 2000, so it was up to the users to decide what they're going to do with it. So there was no real contact with the users. Now we try to maintain this contact with the user forum. So also we have some people available at the institute, so who will also work for the user forum. Okay, so so what is the present situation of coherence? And so the Coherence V2 version was officially released in 2009. It was not on the website, but then it came. So some persons, some users got copies from the existing code at that time. And at that time, in 2009, so this was one, the basic core, that was available in 2009. All the blue things are the things which are available now, the brown things will come very soon. The yellow things are things for we're thinking about for the future. So to make a summary, so what's new in the code is mainly it's a sediment model. The sediment model we spent a lot of time in, that was in the frame of a new collaboration project. It took about 6 years. It was a national program, it was not a European program, which has a water column transport model, a morphological model, and a dredging relocation model. So that's quite complete. Also new is the model coupler. So that's only recently available. So it's a generic structure based on the MCT software, which is also based in ROMS, for coupling coherence with an external model. So in the project, we did the coupling for the waves with the SWAN model. So the SWAN, so we made agreement with the SWAN developers. So they will make a release of SWAN with corrections brought in for making the coupling to coherence. So we did the correction, but they have to approve them, and that's already been done, and they will put it in a future release of the SWAN code, so it will not be available on our website. But the couple itself is part of the model code and can be used, as a coherence application. An interesting thing, because when I was looking at Timo's presentation, they were talking about metallurgical coupling. So the coupler can be used also for metallurgical coupling. So the basics in there, of course you have to put some changes because the parameters are different. But anyways, it is intended to couple with any other type of model. So you can do it also for ice modeling. You can do it also using coupling if you like. One idea was to have coupling of coherence with itself. And that's more complicated because coherence is 3D and the coupling is in the present format is made for 2D. You can use the MCT on 3D, but then you have to do quite a lot of changes in the code. Okay, so okay, for the future, that's for this afternoon. So for those, just briefly, so this is a little bit the history of coherence. So it started as a series of European projects. I don't mention all of them, but the most important one started in 1991. In the MAST 1 and then as a MAST 2 project, so where we constructed the framework model, which is about 6 partners in Europe. Well, the project was a bit more bigger than that, but for the modeling, we had about 6 partners, where each partner developed a model, and that now Arbins was responsible for the integration in the model. That was my task in the project. Afterward, we started with the coherence project, so the effect was based on the previous model here, but we created a portable code with the website, with the documentation, and that is really the coherence V1 code, which most of the users know. In the Odon project in 2003 was another European project. We made a full update of the code, and that was the start of the coherence V2. So the main improvement was the parallelization, so you can use the parallel clustering, nesting, curvilinear coordinates. Something which I didn't mention here is that we put a lot of effort in data simulation. So we put a whole code for the sample gamma filter in that, but it is not in the official releases because we didn't make any updates anymore because we don't have the funding for doing that. Okay, then in 2009 we have an actual project. Well, in fact, it was funded by the Flemish community. So if you know Belgium, so you have the Flemish community, you have the French community, you have the federal government. So we are belonging to the, I'm belonging to the federal government, we are federal institutes. So, but all the other partners were from the Flemish government. So we had two universities, I think there were two private companies, and then we had one research institute, plus our institute. And they provided quite well funding, so we got about 3 million, the whole project costed about 3 million euros. So that's why we could all make all those new developments, especially of the sediments, the wave current interactions, which required quite a lot of work. Okay, so this project is finished. Next week on Wednesday, we will have the final workshop of this meeting, so with all the partners, to have discussions also about the future. One thing they said, yes, but the money is no longer there, so there will be no extra funding for that anymore. Okay. There will be funding for doing things with coherence, but it will come from other sources. Okay, well, just a map you can find on the website about the worldwide distribution of coherence. So I've just verified on the website, now we are about 1800 now. yeah, so I'm going to skip all these, otherwise these are old things. So the things in the international collaboration which you're talking about are things we are ourselves involved with, and the main issue is because we are a scientific institute, but we are not a university, so it means our aim is not really to produce pure science, but we have to do with our modeling must serve the general public. In the same way, must be used as a management and a monitoring tool. That's the basic issue. So I put in some points over here where coherence can be applied. They are quite general, of course. Of course, you think, for instance, of seabirds. Seabirds, okay, they eat fish. Fish eat smaller fish, even smaller fish. At the end, you have a plankton and you have nutrients. And then you come to the whole dynamics of the system, the physics and the biology. And that's the thing we can scope it with the modeling. So protection of beaches and coastlines, so this is, will be quite new because we have now the utilities in the program for doing that. Fishery policies, I had some example given yesterday, what we're doing in our institute. Especially in our international collaboration, this is really a point which always come back. So we have now an agreement with Peru, and if you're talking about Peru, It's fisheries. Fisheries and upwelling, but there are other issues as well. Support shipping lanes, effects of tourism. So those are the points we also which arising in our collaboration with Vietnam. So the aim is that we're going to give support for the modeling of Ha Long Bay, which is a natural reserve park in the north of Vietnam, recognized by UNESCO, but it is now becoming really a very touristic area, and it causes quite a lot of damage to the system. Operational forecast, and the thing, especially in Belgium, but everywhere, the point which is coming back is the climate change. And one of the things we're going to do in the future, and we're going to have money for that, national level, is we're doing the climate change for the next decades with coherence. So that's the things we have been doing in the last years in our international cooperation program. So it's CBIOS DGD project. CBIOS is just the name of one of the departments, so of our institute. So this department is involved in all kinds of cooperation projects with the Minister of Cooperation. So they have a very large budget for, I think, 5 years, and then maybe they can extend it for another 5 years. We have one part of it for marine science. And so we can set up partnership with a number of countries which are approved by the Minister of Cooperation. These partner countries are selected by the ministry, so they have their own objective. So it involves the whole thing of cooperation. Now, when we started in the first phase, it was 2008, we had 41 countries for collaboration. So what I did, I sent a message to the coherence registration list and say, okay, if you belong to one of those 41 countries, you can contact us for setting a collaboration. So finally, we're left with 7 countries, including China, Indonesia, India, Vietnam, Colombia, Peru, and Brazil. Colombia was not on the first, but it came on afterwards. So the aim was that with these countries, so each country be visited by me for giving a training, a 1 week training, and so for setup, for giving general idea for setting up applications. Then we had a visiting program, so the people, especially young people, visited us for 2 or 3 weeks for setting up an application, and then the aim was to get support. It didn't work well for all the countries, because sometimes people arrived, but then when they came back to the institute, they went to do other things. And then, okay, we had, well, I think the best response is of Vietnam, but Vietnam we have a quite intense collaboration. It worked also well with Brazil, so I was in several places in Brazil, and there have been given a start-up of different projects, but the funding is no longer there, that's a problem. In India, so I will just show one example for India, where for modeling estuaries. Okay, and we had also a bilateral project with Vietnam in 2010-2011, so it's Climarca project for the study of the Red River Delta. So now in the new phase of the project in 2014-2017, so the number of countries reduced from 41 to about, I think, about 10. And then there are a number of countries we are not eligible because they don't have a coastline. So in fact, the only partners we left was Peru and Vietnam. They were in the list. They go into disappear at the next phase, so in 3 years' time, so they will disappear again. So we try to contact now mainly African countries. Tanzania is maybe one of the possibilities to have in the future. But we have to see which partners we can keep in this activity. Okay, I'm not going to. So that was an application in Brazil. That was a study we did in the Climarco project for the Red River Delta. So the Red River Delta, it's in the northeastern part of Vietnam, in the Gulf of Tonkin, near the city of Haiphong. So the institute where we had collaboration, which is Institute of Marine Environment and Research, which is located in Haiphong. It's an industrial town with a big port, and it is also an area which is growing economically at a very strong rate, so they have a lot of new factories, chemical plants around that, and environment is not always be the first issue by the government, and so especially at the institute, a little bit anxious about the future. So for instance, Halong Bay, was I talking about, is the area to the north, so it is one of the nicest places for biodiversity known in the world. So with the coral reefs, we have also that islands. Maybe I've seen that in films or in pictures. So there are the rocks extending from the sea. You have made some boat trips. That is really, really marvelous. And you can go on land on the islands, and you have caves where you can visit. But of course, beside the coral reef, you have aqua forming. And of course, you have the tourist industry. And but if you look at, for instance, at the area, so they are starting to build a lot of coastal constructs. With the consequence, you have sedimentations. The sedimentations are affecting the coral reefs. The same, there is a lot of pollution going on. So and the pollution goes into the Halong Bay. And there is a degradation of the coral reef going on. And that's the thing we'd like to study now in our latest agreement we made with Vietnam. But I can tell you, so these agreements we make is not that we're doing all the simulation. Here we did the work because we had a 2 years project and we had one full-time person work on that. But in the future, now in this project, we do the capacity building. So the people are visiting also. Next week we have two visitors coming from Vietnam. They will stay 3 weeks. And now we're going to do to make up all the things, the setup for the Halong Bay, and to use the sediment model. So we give the expertise, and they are going to do the simulations. And when they are back in Vietnam, they can always contact us to have more information or to resolve problems with the simulations. So next year they will come back again, and then we do an evaluation. Yeah, and that's a simulation we did some years ago for in that Climarco project about a simulation of a typhoon of 1970, which produced a lot of damage in the area. That's the simulation so done by a student from India, Vijit, and he's now publishing his results in his PhD on this study. So it was about the Mandovian Zawari estuaries, which are monsoon estuaries. So in the dry season, it takes about 8 months. So the input to the estuary about the rivers here are completely dry, and during the wet season it takes about four months, and you have very heavy rains, and they have a lot of discharge into the estuary, and we see a quiet intrusion of fresh water into the estuary and then in the shelves. And during the dry season the front moves very slowly again towards the head of the estuary. Now thing is, setting up coherence for this area required a very high resolution, because the riverbeds are modeled as well, and which means that it has been. So he did all the simulation on parallel clusters, but he was using many processes to have it running with that resolution. I don't know what resolution it was, but it was very, very, very fine. As you see, especially on this river branch over here. That's something which I've been done working on with when I was visiting Colombia. So Colombia is no longer a partner country, but we had some discussion last month. So when I was in Bogota to see the possibilities for collaboration, there may be some collaborations with Colombia, especially with the Colombian Ocean Commission, because there you have a very central organism that controls everything about marine affairs. I was giving a training in Cartagena 2011, and there were still some people left. So from that meeting, so I didn't have any contact with them. But they like to work again on coherence, but they need to have some support, and that's the thing we like to do. But okay, the thing is still on the negotiation now. Okay, so that was a setup I made for prepared for Gorgona Island. So it's a very tropical island in the south of Colombia, so it's just at 3 degrees north. So it is a very warm island, temperature is always above 25 degrees and very humid. It's inhabited because it's a natural reserve. And the thing is, while to study, especially the physics around the island, the circulations and the temperature, also on a long term, so to see the effect of climate change. So for doing that, so we put it all the open boundaries for the RAMS model, because they're running also RAMS, it's an American model. We give you all the data from the Pacific Ocean for running the model. And it improved things quite a lot. For setting them up for the Gorgona Island, as I mentioned yesterday, so it includes not only the shallow part, but only the deep ocean. So the deepest water depth is about 2,000 meters in the area. Okay. I have prepared an animation for that, but I don't think I have the time now to do it. Another application in Colombia is on the Caribbean coast. So Colombia has a lot of territorial waters, so it's bigger than the country itself. So you have a lot. Also, a large part of the Caribbean Sea is also territorial water of Colombia, and that it's another island in the Caribbean Sea. So where they like to model, so we set up. First set up here for the Rosario Island over here, but we like to extend it at a certain phase to make it a little bit larger. So at the moment we're using 250 meter resolution, but we go to finer grids. That's a collaboration with Peru. Okay, so that's some applications. Maybe I showed that also last year, I think. So these are a few applications we have set up at our institute. So, and these are really intended for modeling and for operational forecasting. This is an operational model for oil spills. Which works to our website, so we can, when there is an oil accident, so we can, we launch to use a particle model, so we launch the pollution, and then we, with our forecast model, so the operational forecast model, we calculate the trajectories of the oil spill, and so it doesn't take much time to do the simulations. Once the simulation is done, so if some areas at the coast are affected, so the authorities are warned about potential oil pollution at the beaches. So it has been used late, so 2 weeks ago, where we had an accident in the Belgian coast, an oil spill over here, about the collision of two ships. And there was oil spilled. It was not a very big one, but before that we had bigger oil spills because there's quite a lot of traffic going on the Belgian coast. So it's mainly in the direction of Rotterdam over here, where we have the big oil terminal. So then you see here how it can be related to the shipping lanes and with the forecast of the currents. That's a validation, so where we use the observations of a slick, and we compared it with the trajectory of a ship, and then so we launched, so we know exactly the position of the ship at what time, and then we launched pollution, and then we see if it can be fitted with the slick, which appears to be correct over here. That is backward tracking, so the particle models, it will be one of the forthcoming release of coherence, so it can be used in backtrack mode, because it is offline of coherence. So you can do it in forward mode, but that in backward, and that is an application for backward. So we have to trace back the position of dead animals. So once we know the time of the dead, we can track them back and to see where. At what place at sea they died. Of course, it is not exact location, so there's some uncertainty in that, but it gives some idea. Okay, that's the fish larvae, but I'm going to skip now. Yeah, that's something. So it's an animation, it's about nutrient tracing. So this is a kind of history tracing. We applied it to a biological model coupled with coherence for the southern North Sea. So for instance, you have we're using a Phaeocystis model, which is the most important plankton species we have in the southern bight. So we had different sources of nutrients coming from rivers, coming from open boundaries, and coming from the atmosphere, and coming from the initial condition. For each of these sources, we used a tag. And this tag is followed in time. And then you can see on the plankton maps, so which plankton is produced by which tag. This way we can see what area the plankton is due. Is it due to input from the Rhine River, or is it to input at either of the boundaries? Is it due to input from the atmosphere? The atmospheric input was mostly, I've heard, negligible. So we have this animation. I can show it now. Hopefully it works. No. Yeah, it works on my machine, but. Yeah, okay, so I will skip it. There was another application for tracing forward and backwards of jellyfish to find out what are the sources and what are the main destination of jellyfish. But okay, the animation here, I don't think it will work here. Same, I will try it. No. Okay, so that was some of the work I've done recently with a sample Kanban filter. So Stephanie is working with me, and he's working years on a Sambal Kanban filter to make a PhD thesis with coherence with the Sambal Kanban filter. So the idea was, if there is interest, to continue this work with this, with the Sambacal filter. But we need to improve the code in order to make a release, and there is a lot of work to be done. So for the moment, we don't have the funding for doing that. So this is a little bit the last work, because Stefan is working on other things now. And so in fact, that was based on the work done during the Odom project, where we started also working on the version 2 of coherence. So the basic idea was that we is the optimal design of an observational network using data simulations. And so, for instance, here you have some of the experiments. So we have a number of observation stations, as seen here with the dots. And we change the position, sometimes we remove from the station, and we see what is the effect on the data simulation. So the idea was, so first we did a simulation with all the stations in it. Then we remove one of the stations, but we applied a simulation still to the neighboring station, and then we see, is a simulation of the neighboring station sufficient for improving the results at the simulation which has at the station which has been removed from the simulation. And so we did Stephanie made a various list of tests, so she's going to publish that. Okay, it is submitted now for the papers, the work done. Okay, so that's a little bit results of here. So the data of our synthetic data, so the synthetic data are obtained for 1 nautical mile resolution model, while for the data simulation we use a 4 nautical mile resolution of the model. So this black line is are in fact the observations, between parentheses, the synthetic data. The red is the one obtained by without a simulation with a 4 nautical mile resolution, and the blue one is the one with a simulation at the station itself, and the green one without a simulation at the station, but with a simulation at the neighboring station. So this way we could compare the effect of the influence of the assimilation. Okay, so that is maybe something, yeah. So here you have an overview of all the releases we made since the origin of coherence. So, so it's the last one is in October 2015. So 2.10 will be in December or in January for the morphology, that's still lacking. And then we have the SIF utility, that's the last one we have to be doing, has been done for our project, which is now finished. Okay, so that's not for now anymore. Maybe I can explain a little bit. So that is the things we are planning to do in the next years at our institute. So we get funding for doing all those new things, and it covers some things but maybe also for interest for you, like for instance the ice modeling. Okay, I will tell you a little bit more this afternoon. So thank you for your attention.